there's one discovers is that the king may be a crook. Traps and titles are like signs, and if you read between the lines, you'll find your first impression was mistook. For a cover is nice, but a cover is not the book.
So remember, we're now at Veer's side of the story. His eyes are about an inch below where they should be on his face, almost to halfway down his cheeks. They slant downward and at an extreme angle, almost like diagonal slits that someone cut into his face. And the left one is noticeably lower than the right one. They bulge outward because his eye cavities are too shallow to accommodate them. The top eyelids are always halfway closed, like he's on the verge of sleeping. The lower eyelids sag so much, they almost look like a piece of invisible string is pulling them downward. You can see the red part on the inside, like they're almost inside out. He doesn't have eyebrows or eyelashes. His nose is disproportionately big for his face and kind of fleshy. His head is pinched in on the sides where the ears should be, like someone used giant pliers and crushed the middle part of his face. He doesn't have cheekbones. There are deep creases running down both sides of his nose to his mouth, which gives him a waxy appearance. Sometimes people assume he's been burned in a fire. His features look like they've been melted, like the drippings on the side of a candle. Several surgeries to correct his lip have left a few scars around his mouth, the most noticeable one being a jagged gash running from the middle of his upper lip to his nose. His upper teeth are small and splay out. He has a severe overbite and an extremely undersized jawbone. He has a very small chin. When he was very little, before a piece of his hip bone was surgically implanted into his lower jaw, he really had no chin at all. His tongue would just hang out of his mouth with nothing underneath to block it. Thankfully, it's better now. He can eat, at least. When he was younger, he had a feeding tube, and he can talk, and he's learned to keep his tongue inside his mouth, though that took him several years to master. He's also learned to control the drool that used to run down his neck. These are considered miracles. When he was a baby, the doctors didn't think he'd live. He can hear, too. Most kids born with these type of birth defects have problems with their middle ears that prevent them from hearing. But so far, August can hear well enough through his tiny cauliflower-shaped ears. The doctors think that eventually he'll need to wear hearing aids, though. August hates the thought of this. He thinks the hearing aids will get noticed too much. I don't tell him that the hearing aids would be the least of his problems, of course, because I'm sure he knows this. Then again, I'm not really sure what August knows or doesn't know, what he understands and doesn't understand. Does August see how other people see him? Or has he gotten so good at pretending not to see that it doesn't bother him? Or does it bother him? When he looks in the mirror, does he see the same Oggie that Mum and Dad see? Or does he see the Oggie everyone else sees? Or is there another August he sees? Someone in his dreams behind the misshapen head and face. Sometimes when I looked at Gran's, I could see the pretty girl she used to be underneath the wrinkles. I could see the girl inside the old lady walk. Does August see himself as he might have looked without that single gene that caused the catastrophe of his face? I wish I could ask him this stuff. I wish he would tell me how he feels. He used to be easier to read before the surgeries. You knew that when his eyes squinted, he was happy. When his mouth went straight, he was being mischievous. When his cheeks trembled, he was about to cry. He looks better now, no doubt about that. But the signs we used to gauge his moods are all gone. There are new ones, of course. Mum and Dad can read every single one. But I'm having trouble keeping up. And there's a part of me that doesn't want to keep trying. Why can't he just say what he's feeling like everyone else? He doesn't have a track tube in his mouth anymore that keeps him from talking. His jaw's not wired shut. He's 10 years old. He can use his words. But we circle around him like he's still the baby he used to be. We change plans, go to plan B, interrupt conversations, go back on promises, depending on his moods, his whims, his needs. That was fine when he was little, but he needs to grow up now. We need to let him, help him, make him grow up. Here's what I think. We've all spent so much time trying to make August think he's normal that he actually thinks he is normal. And the problem is, he's not. What I always loved most about middle school was that it was separate and different from home. I could go there and be Olivia Pullman, not Via, which is my name at home. Via was what they called me in elementary school too. Back then, everyone knew all about us, of course. Mum used to pick me up after school, and August was always in the stroller. There weren't a lot of people who were equipped to babysit for Oggy, so Mum and Dad brought him to all my class plays and concerts and recitals, all the school functions, the bake sales and the book fairs. My friends knew him. My friend's parents knew him. My teachers knew him. The janitor knew him. "Hey, Oggy, how you doing?" he'd always say, and give August a high five. August was something of a fixture at PS22. But in middle school, a lot of people didn't know about August. My old friends did, of course, but my new friends didn't. Or, if they knew, it wasn't necessarily the first thing they knew about me. Maybe it was the second or third thing they'd hear about me. "Olivia? Yeah, she's nice. Did you hear she has a brother who's deformed?" I always hated that word, but I knew it was how people described Oggy. And I knew those kinds of conversations probably happened all the time out of earshot. Every time I left the room at a party or bumped into groups of friends at the pizza place. And that's okay. I'm always going to be the sister of a kid with a birth defect. That's not the issue. I just don't always want to be defined that way. The best thing about high school is that hardly anybody knows me at all. Except Miranda and Ella, of course. And they know not to go around talking about it. Miranda, Ella and I have known each other since the first grade. What's so nice is we never have to explain things to one another. When I decided I wanted them to call me Olivia instead of Via, they got it without my having to explain. They've known August since he was a baby. When we were little, our favourite thing to do was play dress up with Oggy, load him up with feather boas and big hats and Hannah Montana wigs. He used to love it, of course, and we thought he was adorably cute in his own way. Ella said he reminded her of E.T. She didn't say this to be mean, of course, though maybe it was a bit mean. The truth is, there's a scene in the movie when Drew Barrymore dresses E.T. in a blonde wig, and that was a ringer for Oggy in our Miley Cyrus heyday. Throughout middle school, Miranda, Ella and I were pretty much our own little group, somewhere between super popular and well-liked. Not brainy, not jocks, not rich, not mean, not goody-goody, not huge, not flat. I don't know if the three of us found each other because we were so alike in so many ways, or that because we found each other, we've become so alike in many ways. We were so happy when we all got into Faulkner High School. It was such a long shot that all three of us would be accepted, especially when almost no one else from our middle school was. I remember how we screamed into our phones the day we got our acceptance letters. This is why I haven't understood what's been going on with us lately, now that we're actually in high school. It's nothing like I thought it would be.
Tom. Ground control to Major Tom. Take your protein pills and put your helmet on. Ground control to Major Tom.
8, 7, 6.
Commencing countdown, engines on.
3, 2.
Check ignition, 1. And may God's love be with you. Stars look very different.